Peace and well-being. We start in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are glad to be able to be with you to share this School of the Charisms month, April 2020. And for this formation, we are going to start a new segment, the first segment of our formations. And it's called Charism. To begin with, we are going to talk about the word itself, charism. What is it? What do we mean by the word charism? So the definition, we have in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, the definition for the word charism. Charism is specific gift or grace of the Holy Spirit, which directly or indirectly benefits the church, given in order to help a person live out the Christian life or to serve the common good in building up the church. This is what we are going to discuss. This presentation is about the charism of the poor of Jesus Christ. What is this gift of the Holy Spirit giving to the poor of Jesus Christ? And how do we live it out? What are the specific characteristics of this gift when talking about us? So to define our charism, we have the name of this first formation. Jesus all of Jesus. This is our characteristic. This is what defines us. Jesus all of Jesus. This is the sentence that encompasses and summarizes the whole charism of the poor of Jesus Christ. And this charism is found in our sources. If you look at the bottom of your document, you're going to find the definition for OS. You're going to see it throughout our formations, not only this one, but the ones that are going to come up. And this abbreviation means our sources. This expression means to the content of the rule of life of a given institute. In our case here, our rule of life, the rule of life of the poor of Jesus Christ. So this first sentence, Jesus all of Jesus, is our charism. It's found in our sources, and it encompasses all that our charism is about. Here is the motto of our holy charism, Jesus all of Jesus. With this statement, the text of our sources presents us with an itinerary from which we are called to live the gospel. This path is what in Latin expression we call modus vivendi, rule of life. That is the way in which the charismatically interpret, practice, and to better put it, reproduce the life of our Lord in our lives. So, why is there a charism? Why do we have the Holy Spirit giving to a community, to a congregation, a specific charism to reproduce the life of our Lord Jesus Christ in our lives? And in specific ways, and in ways that are important for the church, in ways that are important for the people, in ways to serve, in ways to proclaim the gospel. So our goal, the goal of our rule of life, is to imitate the life of our Lord. It's to reproduce the life of our Lord in our own lives. We simultaneously desire Jesus all and to be all of Jesus. Therefore, in everyone who belongs to the poor of Jesus Christ, there must be a characteristic in their evangelical following. The desire to know and love Jesus as a whole, and consequently, the desire to be entirely of Him without reservation. This is the characteristic of the poor of Jesus Christ. This desire, this bold desire to know Jesus in all His faces, to know Him, to drink from the Gospels, to eat the Word of the Lord, to know Him, and consequently, to desire to be entirely to Him, of Him, to give ourselves completely to Him. So that's where we take it from Jesus, all of Jesus, to know him completely and to be entirely his. Following the same aforementioned text, we find the following expression. There is a deep desire in us, and perhaps even a bold pretension, to want Jesus entirely and to be of him also entirely. This is also part of our sources. So, bold pretension and deep desire, two things that cannot just not exist in one who called himself or herself a poor Jesus Christ. It is a bold pretension to say, I want to know Jesus completely. I want to drink his word and eat his word and to know all his aspects. It's a bold pretension because a whole life, an entire life, it's not enough to know him completely. But we have to have it in us. We need this desire, this deep desire to give ourselves completely to him. Not to hold back any part of us, not to hold back any feelings or thoughts or actions, nothing in us should be left out. It's all entirely given to Jesus. Our founding father, Father Chisholm, commenting on this excerpt, said, in this paragraph, the first of our sources, we find precisely the key words through which we understand, particularly, what differentiates our charism from so many others. A charism is unique. You're not going to find one charism that is exactly the same as another. No. This gift of the Holy Spirit, it is unique. There are aspects in the charism that it's only part of that specific charism. So, what precisely defines us, makes our charism unique? That the ideal of the whole Christian life, and therefore of all consecrated life, is Jesus. We know that well. So, every charism, every congregation out there, every third order, their desire is to have a life offered Jesus. However, it is with a deep desire and with a bold pretension that we want him and we want to be his. Jesus is the goal of every Christian, especially those who are consecrated, those who made a promise to in a specific charism. But for us, poor of Jesus Christ, we do it with a deep desire and a bold protection. The Holy Scriptures are rich in examples that affirm the two attitudes that attribute the peculiar character of our charism. On the subject, Father Schulson says that when looking at the pages of the Holy Gospel, we will notice that there was the deep desire in the heart of each of those who decided to follow the demanding Master of Nazareth. A deep desire can only be nourished if we do not allow our hearts to be divided in the face of other possibilities that life can offer us. Let us remain like Mary Magdalene, Martha's sister, who in keeping herself close to Jesus, chose the best part. According to Father Gilson, a deep desire requires an undivided heart, a heart that belongs only to God. Next, he presents us with a list of men and women of God who had this bold grasp. So we have a list of people from the Gospels, from the Holy Scriptures, from Old and New Testament, who had this deep desire and this bold pretension. So we're not creating it from nothing. Our lives, we try to live it, we try to have it as a reflection of the Scriptures, as a reflection of the Bible, of those who gave us examples, how to follow God, how to be of God, how to love him entirely. Jeremiah, even in the face of his smallness, accepted with bold intent the demanding and zealous invitation that the Lord had given him. just like so many men and women before and after him. Old Noah and old Abraham, the stutter Moses, Jephthah, the bastard son, Gideon, Samuel, David and Daniel, who were still very young, Ruth and Rahab, who were foreigners, Amos, who was a man from the country, Mary, who was an anonymous young woman from an insignificant city in Judea, Peter, James, Andrew, and John, who were fishermen, Matthew, who was a tutor, Magdalena and Margaret of Cortona, who were harlots, Onesimus, who was a runaway slave, Augustine and Francis, who were libertines. These are just a few examples of men and women who, despite their limitations, were overcome by a bold claim to be all of God. So there is no excuse for us to say, I can't. It's too much for me. I can't say that I want to be all of Jesus and to have him all. Because of this, I'm dead, I'm too miserable, I'm a sinner, my past life. No, look at the examples we have. There is no limits for God. All of us were called to this charism. All of us were called to serve Jesus as a part of Jesus Christ. This motto, which is now our theme for reflection, even though it is a simple and objective phrase that summarizes our charism, reveals that we, the poor of Jesus Christ, by assuming the charism, freely, responsibly, and consciously become men and women possessing an element that today is unfortunately lacking in many sectors of our Holy Church: conviction. So if you hear the call, if you feel that you have the vocation to be a poor of Jesus Christ, it needs to be freely given, responsibly given, and consciously given. Why do we have the school of the charism? So we know the charism, so we learn to love what we understand. We learn to believe in what we know. And then our lives change. And then our lives start to resemble what our hearts desire. But it needs to be done with conviction. And I looked for the definition of the word conviction. I love definitions, so I think they help us. So conviction, Oxford definition, a firmly held belief or opinion. So it's a firm held. A lot of things may come to our way to make us give up the decision that we've made once, the yes that we've given to Jesus, to God. But when we held a firm belief in Jesus, in the calling, in the charism, then we keep going. When conviction is lacking, the basic structure to carry out the construction is lacking. And if there are no pillars or foundation, there will neither be a house to be built. Without conviction, any strong wind will make us give up the construction. Any strong wind. Even the times we live in now, of separation, of isolation, of desperation sometimes, of seeing a lot of people suffering, this can shake us. But our charism, our rule of life, what we believe in, our faith in Jesus Christ, tells us exactly the opposite. Conviction. Keep your eyes on Jesus Christ. Keep your eyes on the promised land. What are we looking for? What is our desire? Where is our bold pretension? Where is our deep desire? Jesus all and being all of Jesus is our deep and authentic charismatic conviction. I want just to open a parenthesis. When we say charismatic, I understand that we are talking about charism. It's not, we are not saying that we are a charismatic movement. No, we are not. Although we cannot say that we don't have the characteristics. A charism is given by the Holy Spirit. And if it is given by the Holy Spirit, it is charismatically given. There will be expressions. We have this deep love for the Holy Spirit. But when we talk about charismatic conviction, it's the conviction of our charism that we have when we know and understand our charism. Moved by convictions, we even decided to be a fraternity. Perhaps at that stage in our time, the convictions were simpler and devoid of detrition. For example, I want to be part of this fraternity. This community is my place. Wow, I will be happy in the community and I want to give myself to it. That's the feelings when we begin, when we just find the charism, when we fall in love with it. The fact is that only with firm conviction and certainty that we want Jesus all and to be all of Jesus, we would be possible for us to remain in it. If you come to the community, if you make decision to be a part of this congregation and be called a part of Jesus Christ, understand that your main focus is Jesus. It cannot be someone or something. Even if you feel called to a specific ministry, even if you feel called to serve the poor, or to sing in the choir, or to serve as a member of the theater ministry, a lay associate, understand that your focus is Jesus. It has to be because of Him. It has to be because you want Him all. And whatever He asks you to do, you say, "Here I am, Lord. Here I am." Because this is the only way we will remain in times of difficulties, in times of sorrow, in times of tempests. It's the only way we're going to remain. Therefore, the conviction is not only a gateway to accept and live the charism, but it is also a condition to stay in it. It is not easy to follow Jesus. We do not present Jesus without the cross. It's Jesus with the cross. We are unanimous in agreeing that what attracted us to the poor of Jesus Christ was precisely the differential that it presented us in contrast with other groups. Many of us even had the opportunity to enter other religious communities or dioceses. But we did not do so because the type of life we saw was not convincing. At least for us, at least for me, it wasn't convincing. The proposed model did not correspond to the deepest yearnings of our soul that longed to live the sanctity of the Son of God in a totally evangelical life. All charisms are beautiful and important. All of them. They are unique, they are gifts of the Holy Spirit, so there is no charism that we could put down and say it's not good. The Holy Spirit is good. So, all charisms are good. But God has this way, He chooses us for a specific charism. He has the right place where He wants me to be a saint. And if I'm called to be a part of Jesus Christ, here's where God wants me to be a saint. Here's where He wants me to serve Him and to serve the church and to be witness to the world of His love and mercy. Imbued with a firm conviction for renouncing everything that could distort us from that purpose and determined to seek a place that would guarantee us to live such a life, we found the community. It is clear that one cannot speak of conviction without highlighting its gradual character. Our convictions are not only subject to our natural personal maturation process, but also to the time necessary for the same process to happen. We come full of feelings and joy and happiness, but then we start settling and we find our place, we find the way we want to serve, and God starts speaking to our hearts and we receive formations and we start maturing in our faith, in our spirituality, and we grow. We experience conversion every day and we grow. That is, if we remain on the vine, that is Jesus, our convictions tend to grow little by little, trial after trial, and take root. And this takes time and requires effort and constancy. I've heard many times, like, sister, I don't change, or when I think I'm like one step forward, I take two steps backward. That's the life of the Christian. But you cannot give up. You need constancy. We need to keep walking. We need to keep walking. We need to understand that our eyes need to be fixed in Jesus, in our focus. What is our aim? What are we looking for? If it is Jesus, trial after trial, little by little, we are going to have deepest roots, the deepest roots, and we will remain in Jesus. To be patient and enduring in times of suffering and confusion, it's a really testimony we can give, especially right now. Especially right now. Patience. Endurance. Our faith is so important for the world, for those around us. Our testimony of hope, of joy, and of this belief, this aim that we have, that is eternal life, life eternal in Jesus Christ. It can save many souls right now. Those around us, they might be the poor that we have to serve. At home, we speak about the ministry of listening, ministry of hearing. Sometimes that's all we can do right now. Pick up the phone and listen to someone who is suffering. Or ask people, how are you doing? How are you handling? I'm here for you. I'm praying for you. We are together in prayer. If you need us, please call us to be close to each other, even though we are physically separated. It means that we were attracted to Jesus, to Him. It means that we need to know which characteristics of Jesus all we want to embrace. What the renunciations inherit to this charismatic addition are. It means to be aware that the initiative is His, that we are His eternal disciples, and that it is only true because of love. It is only true because of love. I did nothing to deserve to be called. I did nothing to deserve this charism, God's mercy, to be one of the elect. I did nothing. But He chose me. It's His grace. It's His mercy. I am one like the ones we mentioned, like David and Peter and Matthew and Margaret of Cortona. I am one like them. But He chose us. He chose you. He chose me. We who have decided to belong to charism whose goal is Jesus all, need to assert the radicality of the decision we embraced. We do not want anything other than Jesus. Let's not lose focus. Centered on Jesus, let us decentralize to mission peripheries. What does it mean? Let's look outside of ourselves to those who need Jesus' love. What does it mean to decentralize towards the existential peripheries? It's to pay attention to those who are around us. It's to pay attention to what is happening in the world right now. It's to understand who are the poor that I have next to me. What can I do to be a sign of hope? What can I do to live out my charism right now, the way I am, where I am? What are the possibilities? How can I proclaim Christ right now? Our life lived with authenticity will generate meaning to those who had their lives stolen by consecrated, by meaningless, or at most ephemeral and deliquescent life projects. An authentic, consecrated, secular, or a youthful life frees men and women from drugs and alcohol, from crime and prison, from prostitution and promiscuity, from depression and victimhood, from abandonment and selfishness. How can it be? How can I, just by living out my charism, free people from drugs and alcohol, from prostitution, from promiscuity? How can I free people from depression and victimhood? People see in us something different. People need to see in you something different. Something that generates in them this question: what is it? How can I have it? How can I live like that too? So their lives will gain meaning because we will question them. Sometimes and many times, not with words, but with just the way we live. Just the joy we show, the hope we show when everything seems hopeless. Just by who we are. May this study of ours also have the distinctive marks of our charism. There is a bold pretension and a deep desire to know, love, and live this Jesus all, who enchanted us and attracted us to be only His, and only in Him find the meaning for our existence. May God bless us and help us throughout this whole time, throughout all the formations we have, and may He help us to live out the calling with a deep desire and a bold pretension. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.